morning. Let me first of all thank the president, Mr. Nixon Paul, and organizing chairman for this privilege to come here and share with you our views on the state of the economy as well as on the real estate outlook. Now, just the previous speaker, Dato' Sri, has given you what you call a street level view of the real estate market as well as on the economy, because the economic conditions actually largely, to a very large extent, actually determines the prospects and outlook of your real estate as well. What I'm going to do today, over the next hour, is to take you up higher, perhaps not a helicopter view, even higher, a Boeing jetliner view of what I'll cover today is Asia Pacific, both the economic as well as the real estate outlook. Now, what I'd like to do is, of course, tell you the story of Asia's phenomenal growth. It's an Asian growth story. It's easier to tell, largely because we have a very long track record. Question now is whether we can extend it for another decade or two or even more, indefinitely, to become what they call, as Malaysia is aspiring to be, an advanced industrialized economy by the year 2020. So I will begin with that, as well as give you some current snapshots on the current global economic conditions and what's in store for 2012. And then I'll move on to the Asia Pacific's real estate outlook, covering firstly, what are the determinants of, from a macroeconomic perspective, from a broader perspective, as what actually drives the real estate prospects and outlook for Asia, Asian countries in particular. And importantly, we like to, given the boost, the boom and bust cycles, what they call the bubbles, the property bubbles that have inflicted a major damage on the industrialized economies, especially in the 1998, it was the Asian economies that were affected. And now, more recently, 2008, 2009, we have the combination of a twin collapse of the credit bubble as well as the real estate bubble. See, so that was what hit the global economy so badly. So I will try to give some thoughts, share with you some analysis as to whether this Asian property market, especially the recent performance, that we can actually sustain the cycle, and how long would be the cycle that will last. And then I'll conclude very briefly on the investment prospect, challenges and risks. I think Dato' Sri has very articulately covered most of the risks and challenges for the domestic market. I'll just share with you some very broad-based perspective on what we think from an economics perspective. Let me begin with the Asian growth story. I think importantly, we know that it is not just one or two countries that have experienced rapid growth, but in fact, almost the entire region. And as everyone often know, the large emerging countries, the so-called BRIC economies, Brazil, Russia, India, and China, two of them are actually located in Asia. And if you look at the phenomenal growth of China, especially over the last four decades, it has actually expanded by close to, from 1970 to 2010, the size of the economy has actually multiplied by 30 to 40 times. Malaysia has actually increased over the same period at 16 times. But on an annual basis, China has actually grew at an average real growth of 9.2% annually over the last four decades. That means it has been able to sustain a very high level of growth over a long period of time. And this is really a record achievement. Now, not just in Malaysia, China, but also Malaysia. Malaysia has, as pointed out by the minister, we have actually progressed from a low income to a middle, and now we are classified as upper middle income country. And of course, if you look at the relative size, we are still behind the next, the newly industrialized Asian economies, and these are Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and Singapore. Now, of course, Singapore and Malaysia, if you look at the relative population, we have 28, 29 million. and Singapore with 5 million, they are able to produce almost the size, a GDP size or equivalent to Malaysia. So what it means here is that it's a high income economy. What they basically produce are actually very high value goods and services to the extent that the total value is almost equivalent to Malaysia's size. So as you can see, the lower part of the chart here shows the relative size in 2005 prices. And Malaysia is not too bad there. We have actually grown, sustained a growth of the that to become the second largest country in ASEAN, just next to Singapore. Coming to the global financial crisis, most Asian economies, in fact, they were not very much affected, largely because firstly, they have very strong domestic demand, and more importantly, they do have the capacity to sustain growth over this kind of external shocks, especially the demand, the collapse in exports. So what we have seen here is that we still have what we call a two-speed global economy, whereby the advanced economies are actually growing below its trend growth of 3 to 4%. It is currently hovering at 1.5 to 2% on average for the advanced economies. And importantly, the developing countries, and most of them are largely located in ASEAN countries, Asian region, whereby they are sustaining an average growth of 6 to 7%. Of course, pulled up by China. China is actually has expanded by close to 10% last year, and this year we do expect it to actually sustain a soft landing of at least 8% of growth this year. And 8% would be a fairly very decent performance, given that we do note that even currently, advanced economies are experiencing what we consider a two-speed growth in the advanced economies. Europe, especially the Euro area countries, the so-called countries that are currently hit by the crisis, by the sovereign debt crisis, most of them are already in a recession. And on average, as mentioned by the minister this morning, your unemployment rate has actually shot up to 10.2% on average. So the European countries are facing both the need to reduce its spending, that means it has to embark on an austerity drive, which means it will shrink the economy further in order to meet the bailout terms set by the European Central Bank as well as IMF. So we do have a very challenging times, especially in Europe. But the good news here is that we still have a very strong export-oriented German economy, largely because they are still very productive, very much driven by exports. So we do see some support there for Europe as a whole, but not in the so-called crisis countries that are hit by the both the collapse in the housing bubble as well as the bailout of the banks. And now, because of the government needing to bail out the banks, they have increased their fiscal deficit as well as the government debt level to an extent that the capital markets, the bond market, have lost confidence in their ability to repay. See? So that's why we are looking. This year will be the year that rebuilding the government's balance sheet for the European countries. So it's going to be very challenging, largely because we are still not out of the woods. They are still trying to resolve their second bailout package, and there's a lot of opposition. Although the legislators, the politicians may be able to accept some of the so-called very bitter medicine, but the question now is to what extent they can undertake the structural reforms and then bite the bullet in terms of the severe pain, in terms of your cut in your spending, cut in your living standard, everything you need to cut and work harder. So that would be a very, very strong challenge for Europe, some of the European countries to overcome. But the good news here, as I mentioned here, is the US is already on a firmer recovery. We are seeing a decline in the unemployment rate. The minister mentioned 9.2. Actually, it actually dropped to 8.6, and now it could be around 8.3% gradual, reduction in their unemployment rate. And also because of the rebuilding of their banking system as well as the corporate balance sheet, we are seeing higher level of investments as well as industrial production happen in the US, and that we are seeing a steady rise. So we, at this stage, we are looking at two-speed advanced economies for this year, and that should help, especially for Asian economies that are dependent on exports to these advanced economies. At least we are not seeing the signs that were evident in the first quarter of 2009, just after the outbreak of the 2008 Lehman crisis that triggered the entire global financial crisis. So the signs are not there. So there is greater confidence that we do have slightly greater visibility, and in particular for Asian economies, the fundamentals are still there to support that kind of at least a modest to slightly what call below trend growth. But it will not be a hard landing as current indicators would suggest. It will be more like a moderation in the growth. We will likely see a softer first half, but towards the second half, especially if there is a bailout. If the bailout is seen to be more sustainable, they are able to agree to a medium-term fiscal consolidation plan. That means get into their spending cuts and spread their debt, their debt reduction over a period of time that can seem to be credible. Then we do have a conditions for revival of confidence. In fact, as we speak now, the markets there are gaining some confidence that the bailout is more, there's a firmer recovery prospects for the advanced economies. IMF has just released a statement to say that we have slightly, the recovery prospects has actually firmed up. Of course, when you have this kind of positive sentiments, the concern here is that it may, because of the tremendous amount of quantitative easing that has been mounted by the US Federal Reserve, and they have committed to a low interest rate environment until 2014. So with this kind of commitment, together with the massive injection of liquidity in the financial system, and then now, as part of the bailout, the European Central Bank have also injected something like $500 billion into their banking system in order to shield, in the event of a breakup or a default by the Greece, all the European banks are sufficiently strong. So with this amount of liquidity in the global financial system, we are actually seeing a repeat of what causes problems in the future, because we are just postponing because of too much money chasing after too few goods or assets, and that itself is another, it creates the kind of conditions for another boom and then a bust cycle. So we have to be very careful to ensure that the excess liquidity is managed and it do not result in that kind of high inflation and then asset bubbles, asset price increase, and then when the central banks tighten, you have a bust cycle. So you have much more more pronounced swings in all your markets, not just economic growth, but also in different capital markets as well as property markets as well, with these kind of wide swings. Now, the very fundamental underpinning of Asia's growth story is actually very high savings and investment. And this is very easy to understand, largely because if you have high savings, one of the major causes of the global financial crisis was the so-called low savings, under savings, and overconsumption driven by over-leveraging. And that was the macroeconomic cause of the advanced economies' problems, collapse of their economies that resulted in this 2009-2008 collapse. But in Asia, the story is different, largely because the savings rates is, in fact, we are over-saving and for some countries like Malaysia, under-investing. So we do have that savings investment gap provides us with the so-called liquidity. And this liquidity, which amounts, in the case of Malaysia, is estimated at between 90 to 110 billion a year, which is our excess savings. And these savings, in times of crisis, in times of external liquidity shortages, in times of when you need financing, external financing, this 90 to 110 billion of excess savings, that excess liquidity provides a buffer against any what called credit shock or liquidity shock. So that fundamental strength is not just seen in Malaysia, but also in China and most Japan and all other countries, particularly in Asia, because of the high savings culture. And we are very positive that that trend will continue for some time, and that should help us to ride through any global shocks coming from a financial markets. And not just in savings, higher savings, but also Asian countries generally export more than they import. So we do have a current account surplus or trade surplus, and that surplus is also provides us the economies, the increased liquidity to shield itself from any what you call external shocks. So importantly, most Asian countries exporting more than they import, and as a result, what we have what is called a global imbalance. Global imbalance caused by the fact that advanced economies are consuming more than they produce, and Asian countries are producing more than they consume. So we need to adjust. So that adjustment has to come in a smooth and so-called managed manner, so that it do not result in trade wars or in so-called very cyclical swings in trade protectionism and all these so-called ill effects of the fact that if trade flows were to stop suddenly, then we may have another crisis caused by not just by the financial markets, but also by the loss of trade and investment opportunities. Now, if you look at the other aspect of the growth in Asia, Asian growth is also more stable. If you look at the risk, what they call the fluctuations, is actually much smaller compared to other economies. And this is one of the ways when we look at investment opportunities in a particular country, you have to look at not just the returns that you are generating, but how volatile the returns. And this we have calculated. And for a developing Asia, it has the lowest volatility, so lowest so-called fluctuations among all the regions. Malaysia is slightly higher. Malaysia, our what they call, if you recall your statistics, is actually 66%. Your coefficient of variation is actually slightly higher than the average for ASEAN countries, and or quite slightly lower than advanced economies. But on the whole, for Asia as a whole, because of the stable growth in China, India, we are seeing so that kind of lower risk for Asian economy. Besides the strength in terms of the higher savings, we also find that most governments in Asian countries have what they call fiscal surplus. That means they are able to collect more taxes than they spend in government spending. So, but what we find here is that in the case of Malaysia, we have fairly low net government borrowing. Is actually lower than advanced economies, but importantly, we also have lower government debt level. And the current crisis that is happening in advanced economies, you find that like US, their government debt to GDP, which is the total amount of debt they have borrowed relative to the size of the economy, has actually reached almost 100%. And that is already at a level that creates a concern. Like Greece, they hit almost 160%, and now they have targeting to reduce it to 120% by 2020. So you do have a sizable challenge in terms of reducing for those crisis hit countries, but also for potential like large economies like US having a so-called a debt or fiscal crisis, because their fiscal deficit has also hit 10% of GDP. And if you remember in pre-1998 crisis, our fiscal deficit, when we hit 5 or 6%, there already a huge cry in the market as to whether it's sustainable. So currently what we see now is the US has actually reached 10% of GDP, and the debt level has actually hit 100%. So there's some concern. These are the structural problems impeding, or what they call, that will likely pose problems for what they call a high growth or sustainable growth for the advanced economies. Now, the other strength that we see in Asia is that most of your economies have full employment. Unemployment is actually relatively low. In the case of Malaysia, it's only 3.1%, but on average, it is about half the rate that you see in the advanced economies, and that suggests that that there is a fundamental strength in supporting the overall growth of the economy. And the rising trend is actually the regional economic integration. So one positive development following this global financial crisis is that we like to think that we have a new global landscape. Even due to the need to rebalance rebalance the demand from exporting to advanced economies to actually spending more within the region. That means we have to increase our cross-border trade and investments, and this is where the opportunities, as mentioned by Dato' Sri just now, Malaysian firms are actually internationalizing and looking for opportunities elsewhere. And there's a lot of rebalancing, especially even among the sovereign wealth funds, like from Singapore, China. They are looking at increasing the asset allocation within the region. Of course, we are lucky. We will be benefiting from a lot of inflows from Singapore. They are also looking at not just as safe assets in terms of government securities, but also investing directly in companies as well as in the real estate. And that has a direct stimulus to the economy. In the case of Chinese investments from mainland China, we are seeing they are more risk averse. They only invest in government bonds. So we hope that if in the event that they do diversify their investment to include direct investments, that means investing in companies as well as buying up Malaysian assets, then we will see another very strong push in terms of our attractiveness to foreign investments. The FDI, as I mentioned, I think because of the better growth and investment prospects, we are seeing a rising trend in terms of capital inflows to the Asian region. And this is one of the key beneficiaries that is actually giving a big boost to the economies in Asia, both in terms of the portfolio flows, which are the financial flows, but also in terms of direct investment in properties, investment in companies, and setting up plants and facilities in the Asian region. So these are a very positive trend that we see will likely continue, largely because growth prospects is better, investment outlook is also more positive, and then very important for short-term investors, the portfolio investors, they are looking at higher yields because we have a positive interest rate differential. Our interest rate is much higher than the close to zero interest rate in Japan, in US and Europe. That interest rate differential is also driving the short-term portfolio flows. So we get a lot of money. Of course, the bad news is that too much of this liquidity, if it's not carefully managed, will result in some either sharp price escalation in the financial assets, or what we are concerned about, of course, in this sector in the real estate, the property market. And I will take a quick look at what determines the real estate outlook now. From a macro picture, now we move on to what actually determines real estate outlook. Now, I've already covered most of the key determinant is actually the economic growth. So GDP growth, population growth, as well as the financial conditions. These are some of the key determinants. And of course, on the supply side, very important, the availability of land and the construction costs. These are some more market-specific factors that actually drive individual markets because they are all at different cycles in terms of the different trends of the underlying determinants, either in terms of population, in terms of income, in terms of the distribution of the income groups. All these have different demand characteristics and also, as mentioned by earlier on, you have also institutional factors that actually drive the market. These are like the degree of ease of doing business, property rights, the access to financing and all that. Those are very specific institutional factors that actually affect the property market. And then, of course, there's also very close correlation. Most Asian markets now have moved from fundamental demand to what they call investment demand type of property. So people are buying not just to live in, not just as a house, as a home to stay, but also as an investment. It's treated now as an investment class. As you heard just earlier on, 40% actually have owned second house. So it has become, we cannot analyze the property market from a fundamental perspective. We have to analyze it and treat it as a corporate finance type of activity now because it's now becoming an asset class for investment. So this is where asset prices, the equity prices is too high, then you see a reallocation of the portfolio from equities to property. So there is a shift, so-called portfolio reallocation among the asset classes now, especially when you have very deep or what they call secondary markets for each of these asset classes like equities, bonds, fixed income, for bonds and then or real estate REITs and all these are becoming what they call popular asset classes. And these are the so-called financial deepening that is actually driving a lot of a lot of activities in these markets, and also it also result it created a lot of services subsectors like real estate, all these intermediaries activities. If you look at population growth, I think except for China, Japan, most other Asian countries have very what they call very young population, and in the case of Malaysia, our population growth has actually declined from 3% to right now it's about 1.9% annual increase. But importantly, we have to look at the age structure. The working age group is actually rising, increasing at a higher rate, which is about, currently we estimate to 3%. So your housing supply has to increase by more than 3% in order to meet the 100% of the needs of the increased number of working age population. And this working age population are the ones that will be the first-time homeowners and all that. So that structure is also, in the case of most Asian Pacific countries, we have a relatively young demographics profile that suggests that there will be continuing demand, and then with rising income, property will be a key sector for growth, as we can see. And we also note that there's a very close correlation between economic growth and property prices. In fact, it's about, if you correlation coefficient, if you know, is about 0.6. That means it moves closely together between the economic GDP growth and your property price increases. So very close correlation. And you find that this will be a key monitor, key determinant of how you look at the prospects of the property market. And if you look at 6% growth, you will find that you'll likely be able to sustain property market of 4 to 6%. Increase in the average prices. The rising income, very important factor as well, besides population demographics, the income growth is also driving, and we can see the per capita income, that means the increase in the income of each person or per capita, it's also a very important determinant rather than the overall GDP, because the overall GDP, the economy can actually expand, but what is important is the purchasing power, the individual. So as you can see here, China has expanded very rapidly. Of course, ASEAN countries will be the second fastest growing in terms of the relative growth. The other challenge that we see, besides income, we have to ensure price increases are not at the level that creates what we call unsustainable rate of increase, whereby it actually results in what we generally call as asset bubbles, which is actually very hard to define because, as I've said sometime ago, you wouldn't know that there's a bubble until it bursts. That's, you can confirm there's a bubble. But the problem here is that we need to ensure the general increase in the cost of living do not translate into rising prices for our asset to the level that it becomes unaffordable and creates social problems. So that's also a very important determinant. The overall impact of the overall rise in the cost of living impacting on the asset prices. And also, when asset prices increase, rental also increases, and that also affect the cost of doing business. So there is a very close feedback loop between the different prices, price increases of different assets, as well as the overall inflation. So I think importantly, the trend over the next few years is that if you have very strong growth and we have very strong commodity demand, especially by the large emerging countries, then you'll find inflation will be very strong. And that will be the main problem confronting the emerging countries or the Asian countries. And if you look at what's happening in the tiger, so-called emerging tigers like Vietnam, the fact is that they could not manage the inflation. And as a result, their investment the growth prospects as well as investment prospects has declined largely because if inflation basically ran out of control. And China also, we are finding the rising cost of doing business to the extent that the gap, the what they call the manufacturing, the cost of manufacturing in China has actually risen to close, to be very fairly close to Malaysia now, to the extent that now they are even investors are coming back, and we are seeing an increase manufacturers actually looking at investing in Malaysia on the based on the fact that the cost of doing business in China has risen. So that also is we see as part of the rebalancing of growth opportunities within the region. So it's not all the growth prospects are all lie in the big emerging countries, the low cost industry, low cost economies, but also in countries like Malaysia where the infrastructure are better. And if you are able to contain the cost of doing business, then you still will remain competitive relative to the other countries. But inflation is still a major concern, largely because this is one of the key factors that beyond, especially for those who are dependent on oil, dependent on energy imports, then you have problems in trying to cope, given that most economies have to have some form of a buffer from these rising energy prices. And because commodities are now being traded and there's what you call markets for all these commodities as a result of speculation, because of the quantitative easing as well as a tremendous liquidity in the global financial system, there's a reallocation of the so-called asset into commodities investment, and as a result, that is also contributing to the sharp increase in the commodity prices. Of course, commodity prices, the other factor is, of course, your supply shocks. And supply shocks is also getting very frequent. We have unpredictable weather changes and widespread environmental problems, and as a result, you have a major supply shock to production. So that is still a concern that we expect to be a major factor in looking at the outlook. As I mentioned earlier, dependency ratio, the rise in working age, for most countries in Asia, we see a declining number of people who are dependent. So the working age group is actually rising, with this it's falling. So we do not expect the shift to happen until 2025 to around 2035. So that we still have another decade or two before our demographics become what you call old, or what you call aging population issues will kick in after 2020 in the case of Malaysia, whereby the number of so-called senior citizens, those who are age 65 and above, will probably hit about 10% of the total population. And that will be the time of, well, of course, this shift, this demographic shift also present opportunities for different type of lifestyle property development, you see, because you have increasing number of people who are retiring and who have the ability to pay, and they want a different lifestyle from some of the different property projects that we see. Some of these issues are also, you have to build into the changing trends and consumer preferences in terms of your designing your property launches. Now, the other factor that we see as very important contributing to growth here is urbanization. So this one, I won't go into it. We see a very sharp increase. In fact, ASEAN countries, on average, 50% of their population lives in urban area. In the case of Malaysia, 70%. We have 70% of our population actually live in urban areas. That was a shift from in 1960, it was 30 in the urban, 70 in the rural. Now it's completely turned around. So we are what you call a highly urbanized economy now. Most of the population lives in the urban area. And the other development that we see very important is actually real estate finance, because real estate financing with the deeper markets, both in terms of the banking system as well as a supply of funds from the capital market, that is also creating a lot of opportunities for new innovative forms of financing to raise capital, and that particularly the creation of REITs, the real estate investment trust, and that has actually unlocked the liquidity of a lot of property development companies to the extent that now they can have the capacity to expand further and undertake more investment projects because of these new financing or innovative financing products that we see. Now, let me quickly run through this $64 question as to whether we Asian economies have a property bubble or not. It's a very favorite question. Largely, in the case, we have seen very sharp increases in Hong Kong, in city-states like Singapore, and in the case of Malaysia, in urban areas like KL, Johor Bahru, even KK also facing very sharp increases. Now, if you look at from a macro perspective, what I'm presenting here and analyzing here is actually the changes in the price levels. Of course, your different property segments in different areas will have different patterns, and you have to analyze it differently. See? But if you look at Malaysia, you'll find and compare with other countries, Malaysia price level has not shown any big drops. So what it means here, we have fairly stable price level. Even through the different economic cycle, it will keep on increasing. So we have been puzzled by this so-called, when we do this cross-country comparison, because if you buy in Thailand, you are subject to very wide swings. And you see in the case of Australia, US, after the global financial crisis, you are still showing a very sharp drop. In fact, the US market, it has been constantly declining over the last 5 years, and you are still dropping. As of the latest number shows that the US property market on a national average is still declining. So you have a bubble that when it bursts, it takes, as in the case of almost 5 years, and they are still not out of the woods. They are still not seeing a bottoming out of the property market. So we are comforted by the professor, the Nobel Prize winner, the one who developed the Case-Shiller. Professor Shiller, he himself mentioned that it is very tough. It's not easy even to after observing and studying the price forecasting of property for the last for his profession, he's still not able to get it right. So it's quite challenging to look at how to forecast property pricing and get it right. See? But as I mentioned earlier, we are comforted by the fact that in Malaysia, the price levels, of course, if you show this and you may create a kind of buying frenzy, and that's what we don't want. because Malaysian price, house prices will not drop given the historical trend since. But this is until after the 1999 crisis. We don't have the pre-98 trends, because pre-98 we have seen a sharp drop of at least 15 to 20% in house prices. Some could even be more. But this is on general, the overall price trend. And it's quite similar to Indonesia, largely because we think because of the rising income as well as rising population demand, and it creates the kind of demand, prices are unlikely to correct sharply. So that could be one of the explanation why our market is so less volatile. Of course, Singapore, we understand because of the shortage of land supply, and the properties are subject to wide swings because of speculative investment behavior. Now, the even more volatile is Hong Kong. You can see you have a very sharp swing. Hong Kong, Korea, and even China, despite all the state control, their property prices are still very volatile, but not in the case of Malaysia. So we have seen an uptrend after the two Lehman Brothers collapse and the sharp recovery. So the sharp recovery in 2010 for most Asian economies. So as a result of sharp recovery in the economy, we're also seeing a very sharp increase in property prices, particularly in Malaysia for certain housing segments, very sharp increase. So the correction that you see here is the Singapore in the red line, very sharp swings. It's not unexpected given the very volatile property market in terms of supply and demand. And also partly because they are exposed to international investors, to the extent that also will drive the sharp swings in the supply and demand. But importantly, I think property market do decline, and when they decline, it can be very sharp. So we do note that property market cycles are very much very much alive, just like business cycle. So the thing to predict house price changes, we take the long-term average and then study the standard, the volatility, how volatile the price swings are. And then we come to this interesting chart, which shows what we call the heat map, to what extent prices have escalated to a level that is what we consider above long-term trend, which is not likely to be sustainable, and which what we term it technically a mean reverting. That means you will revert back to the mean, to the long-term average. So we find that in the case of Malaysia, which is this is for US, advanced economies, you see that most of them are in below the zero, which are all in negative. That means their price deviations are all negative. That means they are all still below the average long-term level. And that is not surprising, given that most of the housing markets are now still in after a sharp collapse, they are still recovering. They have excess supply, and demand is very weak, and also, and of course you have foreclosures pressing down the prices. And importantly, banks are also not lending, so you have a problem of reviving your property market. But if you look at Malaysia and other selected countries, you'll find that in the case of Malaysia, when I did this slide, the green one, it actually in the second quarter of last year, it's actually shot up to more than three, what it calls standard deviation for the long-term average. So actually, I was quite surprised to see this, and a bit puzzled as to whether this is really reflective of the actual situation. And it is not when we calculated this, and then we found that IMF recently issued a report, and they also highlighted, and the calculation was also almost three standard deviation. Our price increases last year, especially in the first half, three standard deviation above the long-term average for Malaysia. So we are comforted that our calculation was in line. But that was the second quarter. But fortunately, the third quarter, it has eased to just one standard deviation for the long-term average. So if the price increases are within this band of one standard deviation, we'll feel more comfortable. So we think that price increases should not be allowed to rise for too many consecutive quarters, especially if it lasts over a couple of years, then it will create the kind of problems that you find in the other the boom. Property market booms in other countries that subsequently result in a bust. You see, so based on this, of course, it is also in line with what we see currently, a slowdown in the property market, largely because of both the tightening imposed by the central bank, and as well as by the banks in terms of lending, and that actually should help to moderate it to a more sustainable increase. And our long-term average, as I've shown earlier here. For Malaysia, it's only 4% increase. So on long-term average, 4.1%, and your standard deviation is 2.3. So anything above 6-7% increase in the price in the house prices over a sustained period of time, that we'll consider that kind of situation cause for alerts or what you call a red sign for caution in terms of ensuring that our the bubble does not increase at a level that is not sustainable. I won't go into the last couple of slides. Basically, to conclude here is that Malaysia, we do have favorable growth prospects, particularly for the medium to long term. In the short term, we may experience that kind of knocks in terms of a very soft patch and all that, but the fundamentals are there to support, like in the case of Malaysia, fundamentals are there to support at least a 3-4% GDP growth. Largely because we have a population increase of around 2%, and then you increase your capital by, increase the rate of investment by another 2%, you get a capital contribution from capital of around 2%. So it's on average around 4%. And then you add in your total factor productivity increases of 0.5-1%, you already can achieve at least a 4% growth on the what they call the potential growth of the economy. But of course, this is a potential output. What actually hits the economy is actually the changes in the demand, because demand is more subjected to consumer sentiments, investor confidence, and all that. So that's why you can see the economy going through that kind of fluctuations. But we are quite positive on Asian economic growth prospects, provided you have socio-political stability. That's very important. And then, of course, other factors that I mentioned earlier, low unemployment rates, high savings rate. We are also moving to a market-based economy. Further liberalization will also make the economy more competitive. And this competition that is driving the entire region, further opening up the market, will provide the kind of support. So we do have a very favorable Asian, and of course, as you all know, Asia will still continue to be the fastest growing region in the world for the foreseeable future. And for the medium to long term property market, I think it's also, we are also very highly positive, largely because we have a rising population as well as a rapid urbanization, strong demand, expanding infrastructure, and also the deepening deepening of the real estate market through what we call this institutional what we call segment that is creating a lot of investment opportunities across the region. And then very importantly, our financial system is also expanding and increasing in terms of sophistication to meet the different types of financing the demands, not just from the supply side, the developers, but also from the consumers. The consumers, we are also coming up with all kinds of financing scheme. Perhaps the one is two-generation financing and all those are possible to meet the longer-term needs. And then the last one is actually the cross-border flows. I think cross-border investments, which you are seeing now, as I mentioned earlier, increased focus on investment prospects in the region have led to greater cross-border investment within the Asian countries. There are quite a number of challenges. Dato Sri has mentioned quite a number for facing the property market. In the case of, from a macro perspective, I think managing the boom and bust cycle, making sure that it do not increase too sharply, and then after that you have a major market correction. That kind of wide swings is quite it will be a challenge to manage, especially we have so much liquidity over the next couple of years. With the economy that is awash in liquidity, I think we have to be very careful about asset bubbles. And asset bubbles, the more likely candidates are property, especially when there's inflation is high and people treat asset property as a hedge against inflation, and that price expectations will actually fuel the kind of unsustainable price increases. That we have to watch out. But the other thing, I think I already mentioned by Dr. Susri, about streamlining legal and regulatory framework, taxation, land use, and then very important, the social housing. So these are some of the broader issues that are probably not of that interesting to you all, but nevertheless, these are some of the things that we look at when we look at the key risks and prospects. So in summary, I think the it's likely that property market will progress in tandem with the economy, but we have to watch out for short-term sharp swings, and that swings should not, for in the case of Malaysia, we do have the fundamentals to ride through that. I think that's very important. And of course, you don't tell everybody that the chart is our price index do not show any fall. It's always a continuous rise, because that way fuel further purchases and speculative buying. Thank you.